Good evening, everyone. I hope you're well and welcome to our webinar on treatment for back pain. My name is Morella and I'll be your host for this evening. Our expert presenters are consultant orthopaedic spinal surgeon, Mr. Omar Mohamed, and interventional radiologist, Dr. Mo Faris. The presentation will be followed by a Q&A session. So if you'd like to ask a question during or after the presentation, please do so via the Q&A icon, which is on the bottom of your screen. This can be done with or without giving your name. If you would like to book a consultation, we have Chelsea Dan from the private patients team on hand to take phone calls after the webinar, and we'll provide the telephone number at the end of this session. Please note the webinar is being recorded. I'll hand over to Mr. Omar Mohamed and Dr. Mo Faris, and you'll hear from me again shortly.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to talk today about what back pain is. How do we aim to help patients with back pain, how you can also avoid back pain, and what treatment options are available to anyone who suffers from back pain. Next slide, please. Back pain is fairly common. Probably about 8 in 10 of us will experience back pain at a certain stage. Back pain can start without any specific cause. Back pain can also occur after lifting or handling any heavy object. Twisting awkwardly can also cause back pain. To be honest, in most cases, back pain will start without any precipitating factor. Luckily, most episodes of back pain are self-limiting. Back pain is really, what is back pain? Back pain is any pain felt from the bottom of the neck all the way down to the bottom. The lower back is probably the most site of back pain. Neck pain would probably be the next common, and then thoracic pain, which is pain in between the shoulder blades. Anything in the spine can cause back pain. That's why sometimes back pain could be poorly understood and treated as well. The spine simply is made of bones, which are more or less circular. Those bones, what we call vertebrae, are connected to each other by ligaments. In between them, there is the disc, and attached to them, the muscles. And in the middle is the spinal cord, and subsequently, the nerves come out from the spinal cord, right and left. Next, please. Back pain is something that could be dealt with, and there are various treatment options for that. The problem with back pain is that sometimes we can't localize where exactly is causing the back pain. Is it coming from the muscle? Is it coming from the joint or coming from the disc? Back pain could sometimes be associated with pain shooting down the leg. This is probably caused by a nerve which is trapped in the lower back. Although the problem is in the lower back, however, you feel the pain shooting down the leg. Next, please. Back pain, what is the classification of back pain? Back pain can be non-specific or specific. The majority of back pain is non-specific. It doesn't really help with a clear diagnosis. However, the good news is that there isn't any underlying significant or sinister pathology. So probably about 80% of back pain would fall into the category of non-specific. Specific causes of back pain can be caused by osteoarthritis. As we age, the joints lose their articular surface or where they usually move freely, and hence we can experience back pain. Other causes can be, for example, rheumatoid arthritis, osteoporosis, where the bones become weaker and then subsequently can fracture. Very rare causes can include cancer or infection, but the majority of the causes of back pain are non-specific. When should you ask for medical advice? As I said, most of the episodes of back pain will be self-limiting. However, if the pain becomes persistent, constant, getting worse and not improving, then this is something that you should seek medical advice for. If you have any loss of feeling in the bottom or any weakness in the leg or any numbness, this is again something that would warrant seeking medical advice. Next, please. What will happen when you seek medical advice? The medical practitioner or the specialist will ask you a few questions. This is what we call history taking, to just know when the pain started, how it is progressing, are there any, for example, underlying worrying things like, for example, weight loss, fever, night sweats, anything like that. And then after that, we might need to request some investigations. This might include a blood test, a simple x-ray, or we might even need an MRI scan. How can we treat back pain? The first line of treatment is usually to stay active, even despite having pain. You won't cause any further structural damage. And you also need to stay at work. Painkillers will help as well. If this doesn't improve the episode of back pain, then the first stage would be asking help from a physiotherapist, what we call musculoskeletal rehabilitation. After that, if there is no improvement, there is a role for spinal injections. And Dr. Mo Faris will talk about that in a bit of detail. Very rarely surgery is required for back pain. However, there are a few cases where surgery for back pain can help. If there is weakness or leg pain, surgery can help a lot in those instances. Next, please. What are the important tips to avoid back pain? Most important thing is to keep mobile, active, exercise regularly, musculoskeletal rehabilitation, core strengthening exercises, swimming, cycling, keep fit and active. The old advice, if you have back pain, bed rest, there's no evidence behind that. This has not proven to be of any benefit to patients. That's why if you have pain, you must stay active and keep your activity level. You must also look after your back. So lifting, handling heavy objects, awkward twisting movements, all those things should be avoided. Next, please. Thank you.
Just unmuting myself. So hi, I'm Dr. Mo Faris. I'm a consultant interventional radiologist. So what I'm going to be talking about in my part of the talk will be the different types of spinal injections. So should conservative management, i.e. the things that Mr. Omar Mohamed has spoken about, don't work, and we proceed on to doing spinal injections, what are our options or what are your options? So I'm going to talk about the different injections, what they will look like, how we perform them, and then after that we'll answer any questions. So you can see from this slide there's a multitude of different ways we can tackle different pain coming from different areas within the spine. So is it related to the facet joints, which in essence are the hinges at the back of the spine? Is it related to impingement from a nerve? So commonly a slip disc would be impinging on a nerve. And these would dictate what we can offer and what type of injection is likely to be successful. So first would be a nerve block. So this is commonly either in the neck or in the lower back, most commonly in the lower back. So most people would know about sciatica, where people have said to slip the disc and pressing on the sciatic nerve, which then radiates down to the foot. So we tackle this with CT guidance, and what this will involve is an outpatient procedure. Come in and we use CT to target it next to the sciatic nerve and then inject a block, and the block consists of steroid and long-acting anesthetic. This is a walk-in, walk-out procedure, so it's totally as an outpatient. We ask you to sit for 15-20 minutes, obviously not drive back home, and then you can go home and within a few days we'll see how much of an effect it's had. Because, as Mr. Mohamed was saying, that the pain can be quite difficult to be certain where it originates from, a lot of these injections are also diagnostic. When we say diagnostic, what we mean by that is that the cause of the pain? So we would suspect, say, from an MRI, there appears to be compression. There also may be some degenerative changes also, now which part is actually causing the issue. So by doing a block or doing an injection, we would also be able to see, is this the cause of the pain? So for example, from a personal point of view, I had sciatica approximately 10 years ago from a slipped disc as a very, very young man. After a year, it was a lot of pain. I had an injection performed by one of my colleagues at the time. I was at St. Thomas's. And it gave me a reasonable amount of relief, but then started to wear off. And after about a year and a half of quite significant pain, I was operated on. So it gave the surgeon the confidence to know that that's the area to tackle if it comes to a point where we have surgery is indicated. So the injections can be from the neck. So these are common sort of neck injections. This is a cross-sectional image of a CT scanner. And what it essentially involves is that's the front of you, you're lying on your back. This is the neck, that's the trachea, the windpipe. The white stuff here is bone, and this is the spinal cord, and that's the cervical nerve coming out, and that's the needle itself. So you can see the accuracy we can get with these injections. This is a pictorial thing of what we're trying to do. So if you've got a herniated disc, which is compressing on the nerve root, the needle will then inject the steroid and the long-acting anesthetic as the nerve exits. That's just a different approach. So these are examples of other blocks. So these are all examples of nerve blocks. This is the fifth lumbar, which again, you can see what I do is I inject contrast to see exactly where the steroid is going to go. And this thing here is the nerve itself. So you can see the level of accuracy we can get. And what this gives us is a degree of confidence that if you have relief, then great, this is the likely cause of it. If you don't have relief, because we can see how accurate we can get to it, then we'd have to have a rethink as to what is the actual cause of your pain. And that's when I say the diagnostic component to it is important. And that's the classical sciatic nerve. So this little, looks like a little eye, that's all bone, that's in the sacrum, this is the back. So we're coming from the back, pretty straightforward. These injections generally take about 10 minutes and we can target the sciatic nerve very, very closely. And this is exactly what I had. This isn't my CT. I've got far more muscle on the back. So anyway, so we targeted it and we see how well it works. There's another type of injection. So the sacroiliac. So this is right in the pelvic area. This can be quite inflamed. It can be acute, so which meaning it can be an acute inflammation, or it can be long-standing inflammation which becomes chronic. And the advantage of these is that we start off with the injection. And what I'll talk about is the facets as well. So the two with the sacroiliac and the facet, what we now do is have a denervation procedure. So what we do is we start off with a diagnostic facet injection. So this is an example of what the facet joint is. So when I said it's the hinges at the back, this is what we mean. So there's your remnants of the canal and that's your nerve roots. And this is actually the facet joints itself. So we can target the facet joints with a steroid block to see whether it works. This is sort of a more understandable picture. So you have innervation of this joint itself with these facet joints. We call it medial branch blocks because the medial nerves innervate this area as well. So you can call it either or. And we inject it first of all. And if you get a positive response and improvement, what we don't want to do is keep every few months injecting steroids into these areas because of the increased risk of localized infection and osteoporosis. So we limit the number of injections. And what we do is we do an injection, prove that this is the cause of your pain, and after which we can then step up to this. So this is called facet radiofrequency denervation, rhizolysis. There's a multitude of different names for it. And what we're doing is where we've proven that your pain is coming from particular levels of facet joints, we can then burn, using a small heat source, the nerves that innervate that joint. So as we saw previously, these are the medial branches. And what we do is we target these, done under CT again, and they're small little needles. They're not much bigger than the needles we use to actually inject steroids into. We attach it to a probe and we burn these nerve endings. And what we burn is the nerve endings that sense pain but don't supply the muscles. So they're the two sorts of, we do a few tests to just to check that we're in the right area. And this is another sort of example of it. So we are checking to see which is the pain generating nerves. We then target them. This is performed without a general anesthetic. This is performed as a day case. So what the procedure actually involves is we get you, bring you in. We use it again, the CT scanner. We pop local anesthetic into the skin under CT, then inject the needles and the laser fibers. We then test the two tests. So we want to burn the sensory nerves. We don't want to touch the motor nerves. So they're the two tests we do. And then it's only 3 minutes, but because it's uncomfortable because of the ablation, the burning of the nerve endings, we give you sedation. That's what's called conscious sedation. So you're not fast asleep, because obviously we have to worry about your breathing if that was the case. So we give you enough to make sure you're nice and comfortable. Everyone tolerates it very well with that combination of sedation. 3 minutes done, and then that's it. The difference between the steroid block and the ablation is that the ablation can take up to 2 weeks to have an effect. Because you think we're burning the little nerve endings, they can get a little bit inflamed, so you can get some transient discomfort post-procedure for a week or so. And then as the nerves die off, then hopefully you get an improvement. And this improvement is anywhere between 6 to 18 months. And this is now sort of the gold standard for long-term facet degenerative change. For chronic pain. NICE is our National Institute of Clinical Excellence. So what that is it's an impartial government body which looks at the evidence for varying different disease processes and treatments, and then tries to come with the best possible conclusion. It is guidance, it's not an absolute, but we tend to go relatively reasonably follow it. So what it has concluded is the radio frequency denervation is the gold standard. That's the one that has the vast majority evidence behind it. What we do to prove it's the case is do an injection. So we do a medial branch block. As I said, it's the same as a facet injection. And we inject into the areas we think. So the clinical assessment is vitally important. And if we get a positive response, then that's an indication for a denervation. And this can keep, I have patients now into eighth, ninth year and are functioning really, really well and have a good quality of life back with this procedure. And they tend to come every sort of 18 months to 2 years, have the procedure done and then carry on. So it avoids surgery and allows people to actually have a good function back in their lives. So thank you for listening, and we'll answer some Q&As now.
Thank you, Dr. Faris and Mr. Mohamed. We've got a couple of questions here, so I will put those to you. The first one is, I get a lot of back pain in bed at night and have to make sure I put some gel on to ease the pain or else I'm in trouble. Do you have any advice?
If this pain has been long-standing and hasn't been improving, then probably you ought to have some medical advice as to where this pain is coming from. You might require an MRI scan to reach a clearer diagnosis.
Thank you, Mr. Mohamed. Next question. I've had a right side denervation of the facet joint a year ago, which sadly didn't help my chronic back pain. My question is, what, if any, are my options in the future to be able to resolve my pain?
So, I mean, it'd be an interesting one to know, because what I commonly find is if we do one side, there's normally one side worse than the other. So you do one side and it unmasks pain on the other side. And sometimes people will be unsure whether it's worked at all. So I tend to do with those ablations on both sides. I think, unless Omar has a different opinion, I would suggest either a revisiting, depending on whether the injection itself initially worked. So if the steroid injection worked, but the rhizolysis didn't work, I normally would be quite happy to do a second rhizolysis to see whether you could get a larger burn area and actually get some relief. So it really depends on whether the injection, the steroid injection, gave any relief whatsoever. If not, then it would suggest that it's either wrong, targeted the wrong areas or the wrong parts, or whether it's not actually related to the facet joints, whether there's another disease process or something else going on, or whether it's related to nerve impingement instead. Because pain is non-specific, it can be quite tricky to know exactly which is the cause of the problem.
Thank you. Next question. I had a total hip replacement about 7 years ago and have suffered with sciatic pain ever since. Is there anything I can do to improve the pain?
Yes, definitely. If the pain is shooting all the way down the leg, and if it's in a specific area, then this could indicate that there is a problem in the lower back. What we commonly call sciatica, it's a slip disc. Actually, it's not a slip disc, but part of the disc. The disc is a strong fiber string, and inside is a jelly-like material. And sometimes the outer tough ring will give way, and part of the jelly will come out and press on a nerve, hence you having pain shooting down the leg. To be able to reach a definite diagnosis, then probably I would advise an MRI scan to look into any pressure on a nerve in your lower back, which could account for the sciatica.
Thank you. Next question. How many courses of radiofrequency injection can I have in my lifetime?
There is no limitation on it. It depends on whether it works. So it can be your chronic management for your lower back pain. So because the limitations is with steroids, we don't want to be keeping repeatedly putting steroid injections into people's backs. But the radio frequency ablates the little small sensory nerves. They grow back. Depending on how quickly they grow back is how long the relief is obtained for. After which, when it starts to come back, you can pre-perform the ablation. So as long as it's working, it can be repeated.
Thank you. Next question is from Mike. Can you enumerate the risks of the nerve blocking procedure?
So the risks are depending on which area. So if we tackle the lower back, the risk is we make the pain worse. So there's an irritation of the nerve. In 12 years out of that, it's probably maybe a 1-2% risk of making the situation worse by irritating the nerve with a needle. There's a theoretical risk of infection simply because you're introducing a needle into a sterile area. And that's essentially about it with the lower back. There is a theoretical risk of a stroke with the cervical blocks, and that's only because there's been one case of it performed. It wasn't performed under CT, which is what I performed them under. It was that procedure was performed under thoroscopy, but there is a theoretical risk of a stroke because of the vertebral artery, which runs adjacent to the nerves. That's about it, really. So they are pretty straightforward procedures. There's no procedure which is without risks, but it's a very straightforward procedure, which is hence why we perform it as an outpatient procedure. So you literally come in and we do the procedure, you wait 15, 20 minutes in the waiting room, and all being well, you go home.
Thank you very much. Next question is from Anna. Do you have any experience of the Alexander technique said to change the way the back is used?
Yes, lots of patients report very good improvement with the Alexander technique, and it is certainly something that you should try in the first instance. It's also worth noting that the radiofrequency denervation is part of the treatment. It is not really aimed to be the sole treatment for back pain. So you have the denervation, you have improvement in your symptoms, then you can focus more on your core muscles, strengthening them, for example, by the help of a physiotherapist. or, for example, by joining a Pilates class. Swimming as well is very good for strengthening the core muscles.
And that's my personal experience as well. So from a personal point of view, I had my sciatica operated on and decompressed, but after which I had lower back pain, and functional exercises kept it at bay. So it was quite painful afterwards, but it gave me the ability to then perform functional exercise such as Pilates. I did a lot of kettlebell swings. I found was very, very useful. And that the core stabilizer becoming stronger stopped the pain.
Thank you very much. Next question. My husband is a lorry driver who has suffered with sciatica for years. He's tried physio, but to no avail. What's the next step?
There hasn't been improvement with what we call conservative management. Then the next step would to seek advice from specialists. Again, an MRI scan would be indicated over here to look into if there is any nerve which is compressed in the lower back, accounting for the sciatica. We do know that certain jobs, people who do certain jobs are more prone to back pain and problems with their discs. One of them is, unfortunately, HGV drivers.
Thank you very much. Next question is from Jean. I have had compression fractures in T5 and T6 due to osteoporosis and get a lot of pain in that area. Would an injection help me?
I would suggest that the first line of treatment is to deal with the underlying problem, which is treatment for the osteoporosis. You should first instance get a DEXA scan. It's a type of scan that tells us how bad the osteoporosis is, and subsequently you should be put on the appropriate medication for that. Also, I would like to stress the importance of a healthy diet, regular exercise. All those things are very important for improving the quality of the bone. Coming back to your question with injections, first of all, if there is still a fracture which hasn't healed, there is the option of injecting cement in the bone to help with the symptoms. However, if when you get an MRI scan and it shows that the fracture has healed, yes, sometimes when a fracture happens, there is a bit of stress on the joints, what we call the facet joints, and targeted injections there can help improve the symptoms.
Thank you. Next question. How soon can I drive after treatment for a slipped disc?
It really depends on your symptoms. For example, some patients with a slipped disc will have weakness. In this instance, we do not advise any driving. But if you have, for example, a nerve block, an injection to block the pain, and you have good improvement in your symptoms, then and you can stop the car in case of an emergency, then by all means, you can go fairly quickly back to driving. Patients who have surgery for a slipped disc, the advice is usually 4 to 6 weeks' time. But again, it's depending on how quickly they have improvement in their symptoms.
Okay, next question is from Kim. What is the best way to differentiate whether hip pain is coming from the hip or spine femoral nerve?
This will require a good history taking from a specialist. An examination would be very important also to differentiate between whether the problem is coming from the hip or from the spine. After history taking and the examination, you will require investigations. Depending on what the specialist feels, if the problem is really coming from the hip, then we'll investigate the hip further.
Thank you. Next question is from Carol. My back pain is when I stand up from sitting and can be particularly bad if I have previously been standing or walking for a long time. I have to gradually straighten up before being able to move. I think that's kind of what advice would you give?
Again, it depends how long has this been going on for. Have you tried any, for example, physiotherapy? Have you seen a specialist? You might need, if it's long standing, some investigations, perhaps to start with an x-ray.
Okay. Next question. I work as a plumber, so always lifting heavy items and bending down. I have lower back pain all the time. How can I manage this without it affecting my job? Should I be doing any particular exercises to help?
Yeah, all heavy manual jobs, and specifically what you are doing, you will definitely have back pain. And I think on the long term, the best option is to focus on your core muscles, or what we call musculoskeletal rehabilitation. There is a very good website called backcare.org.uk. But if you just Google backcare space exercises, it will take you straight away to that website. And there you can find very useful exercises and tips for back pain.
Thank you. A few more questions to go. I'm 30 weeks pregnant and have terrible back pain. I'm worried that it won't go away after I give birth. What are my options to help relieve the discomfort?
Usually the pain is related to the pelvic girdle, and it is well documented in pregnancy back pain. It tends to improve after pregnancy. If it doesn't, then there are a few options. Again, first line of treatment would be input from a physiotherapist. If there is no improvement, then we can investigate this further.
Next question is from Amy. I have had pain at the lowest part of my spine after I stand long time at fixed position, e.g. work in my kitchen. The x-ray result was explained to me. It's degeneration of the bone or the things around or between the bones. Any suggestions for treatment?
We'll just have to be a bit careful where is the pain coming from, because the lower back can be actually, yes, from the facet joints, or it can be coming from the sacroiliac joint. The sacroiliac joint is the joint which joins the pelvis to the axial skeleton or to the vertebral column. Both of them, there are treatment options for both of them. If there hasn't been any improvement with conservative measures, then definitely, and we are sure where the pain is coming from, then targeted injections there for the facet joint, what Dr. Mo Faris has explained, can help. And for the sacroiliac joint, under CT guidance, can also be beneficial. But in the first instance, we need to know where the pain is coming from.
Thank you. Next question, would you recommend acupuncture?
Acupuncture is not recommended by NICE. However, lots of patients do have improvement from acupuncture. So I would advise, yes, you to give it a go.
Thank you. Next question is from David. Do you recommend treatment from a chiropractor?
Yes, I have seen lots of patients who have had improvement from seeing a chiropractor. Unfortunately, there isn't one thing that will work for all patients, but something will work for one patient. And I would advise, if you see a chiropractor or an osteopath one session, the pain is worse, then obviously stop.
Thank you. Next question, is there anything I should avoid in my diet to prevent back pain?
So a healthy diet is very important. There isn't anything specific. However, we know that the vertebral column of the axial skeleton is like a crane. This crane is in the back and it is supported by the back muscles. The more weight and load you put in the front, the more the crane suffers in the back. So a healthy diet, looking after your weight, is important.
Next question. I'm 54 and a regular horse rider and have started to get backache. Is there anything I can do to stop it getting worse?
I would recommend you to carry on riding. I am myself a horse rider and I compete regularly. Looking after your back, core strengthening exercises, joining a Pilates class, swimming regularly, front crawl, stroke, all those things can help a lot. Also, painkillers can help a lot in the first instance. If this all doesn't help, then there could be a role for targeted spinal injections.
Two more questions to go. Next question, I'm terrified of needles. Will I cope with facet injections?
Yes, is the answer. So we commonly have people with needle phobia. If someone is extremely bad with their needle phobia, then we can actually give some sedation, and that would just take it from a straightforward outpatient procedure to a day case procedure. So they would just recover for a few hours afterwards. So we do have the option to give some sedation for the injections. We give the sedation always for the rhizolysis, the denervation, but we do have the option to do that.
Thank you. Next question, it's our last question we have. Would losing weight help relieve my back pain? I have a BMI of 40.
The answer is yes, definitely, because you're putting a lot of stress and load on the vertebral column in the back. So offloading this pressure will help a lot with your back pain. So seeking advice from a dietitian, for example, in the first instance, there is also a very important role for bariatric surgery to help improve your symptoms on the long term.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Faris and Mr. Mohamed. If you would like to book your consultation, please contact us on the number on your screen for 8 o'clock tonight, where Chelsea will be on hand to answer, take your details, or between 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. Just to highlight that due to demand for appointments with our back pain specialists, please book as soon as possible for availability in June and July. You will receive a short survey, and I would be grateful if you could spare a few minutes to let me have your feedback on today's webinar. Our next webinar is on the 16th of June with our expert, who will be discussing indigestion and bloating. So on behalf of Mr. Mohamed, Dr. Faris, myself and the team at Benenden Hospital, I would like to say thank you very much for joining us this evening, and we look forward to joining us again soon. Many thanks.